Energy balance refers to the fact that energy intake in a healthy individual should equal energy output. Energy intake refers to all of the energy that's liberated by the oxidation of our nutrients. Energy output is any energy we use. Now, we lose a lot of energy as heat, we use energy to do work, and we store energy in fat and glycogen molecules. Nearly all of the energy from food eventually is converted to heat. All catabolic reactions lose some energy as heat as well. When energy intake and energy output are balanced, the body weight remains stable. But if we take in more energy than we use, we'll begin storing that energy as fat or glycogen and we'll gain weight. If we take in less energy, we will go to our fat and glycogen stores to take that energy out and we will begin to lose weight. However, we're going to find out that the body has some protective mechanisms that protect us from losing weight so that we can maintain energy stores. Obesity is a problem in this country. We measure obesity typically by looking at the body mass index, or the BMI. You can calculate your BMI by taking your weight in pounds and multiplying it by 705 divided by your height in inches squared. You're going to need a calculator for this. You're overweight if your BMI is between 25 to 30. Being overweight carries some health risks. You're obese if your BMI is over 30. People who are obese have markedly increased health risks. Body fat content should be 18 to 20%. Obesity is not well understood at all. People who are obese tend to have a chronic low-grade inflammation. We check this by looking for something called C-reactive protein in their blood. There's no focus for the inflammation. They just seem to have a generalized body inflammation. Also, they show insulin resistance and have a high risk for type 2 diabetes. There's a higher incidence of atherosclerosis, hypertension, heart disease, and osteoarthritis. In this country, 2 out of 3 people are overweight and 1 out of 3 people are obese. 1 in 12 people are diabetic. It would seem that we could regulate food intake and this would help with obesity, but we don't really understand all of the regulatory models here. We know that hypothalamic structures are involved. There are structures called the arcuate nucleus, the lateral hypothalamic area, the ventromedial nucleus. All of these release neuropeptides that reflect the activity of 2 sets of neurons. There's the AGRP neurons. They release neuropeptide Y. This peptide seems to enhance appetite. And then there's the POMC-CART neurons. These suppress appetite. There are some different theories on regulation. They're trying to figure out how feeding behavior and hunger are regulated. We know that there are neural signals for the digestive tract and that these blood-borne signals are related to body energy stores. Hormones are involved somehow, and to a small degree, body temperature and psychological factors play a role. All of these operate through feedback signals to feeding centers in the brain. Some of the things we've worked out, or we think we've worked out, involve some of the short-term regulation of food intake. We get neural signals from the gastrointestinal tract. These come via the vagus nerve. Things like high protein and stretch of the stomach helps inhibit appetite. We have blood levels of nutrients. Rising blood glucose levels tend to suppress appetite, as do elevated amino acids. More fatty acids in the blood also seem to inhibit appetite. So when we're in our fed state, we should have appetite inhibition. The GI tract hormones, insulin and CCK, depress hunger, but glucagon and epinephrine stimulate hunger. Ghrelin is a hormone that's produced by the stomach. It seems to be produced when the stomach is empty, and this stimulates hunger. All of the short-term signals target the hypothalamic centers. Long-term food regulation may be controlled by leptin. Leptin is a hormone secreted by adipose cells in response to an increase in body fat mass. Leptin indicates the body's total energy stores in the fat tissue. The idea here would be that it would seem that if we have a lot of body fat stored, we would realize that we don't need to take in and store more. We would use this up first. Leptin appears to bind to receptors in the ARC. This helps suppress the release of neuropeptide Y, which is your appetite stimulant, and to stimulate the secretion of the CART hormones, which depress appetite. Shrinking fat stores should reduce leptin levels, and then you would reverse that process. However, when they look at leptin levels in obese people, these people have high leptin levels, but they seem to be resistant to its action. The consensus now is that leptin's main role may be to protect us against weight loss, so that if we are nutritionally deprived, we have plenty left to go to. Other regulatory factors play a role. Temperature. If you're hot, you tend not to have much of an appetite. If you're cold, it stimulates appetite. Stress. This can depend upon the individual. Some people eat when they're under stress, others do not. Psychological factors. Again, these vary from individual to individual. There's now a theory that the kind of intestinal bacteria you have may stimulate some of your appetite. There have been plenty of studies done that say that people who don't get enough sleep tend to be obese. Certain adenovirus infections. Adenoviruses are viruses that usually cause mild colds, and some of these may somehow suppress leptin activity. The bottom line is we haven't figured out obesity, we haven't figured out weight loss, we really don't have any good answers to this question about obesity. Your basal metabolic rate, or BMR, is measured by looking at all the heat you produce by all the chemical reactions and mechanical work of the body. The basal rate is just your cost of living. It's the energy needed just for you to sit still and breathe and be alert. There are two ways to measure it. The direct method has you get into a calorimeter. This is a chamber that has a water jacket, and it absorbs all of the heat that you manufacture and determines how many kilocalories of heat you liberated. In the indirect method, you use a respirometer. This measures your oxygen consumption. Thyroxine is the major controlling hormone of basal metabolic rate. There are other factors that influence your BMR. One is age and gender. Younger people have higher BMRs. Declining muscle mass in the elderly may contribute to the lower BMR we see in older people. Males have a higher metabolic rate than females. Again, males have a higher muscle mass and less fat than females. As your body temperature goes up, your BMR goes up. As your body temperature goes down, your BMR goes down. So your BMR fluctuates along with your temperature. Stress will tend to increase your basal metabolic rate, but thyroxine is the most important hormone that drives your metabolic rate. Hyperthyroidism is an increase in thyroid hormone, and it gives a greatly increased basal metabolism rate. The body breaks down stored fats and tissue proteins. You experience increased hunger and food intake, but weight loss occurs. Bones weaken, and muscles, including the heart, may atrophy. In hypothyroidism, there's an insufficient production of thyroid hormone. The metabolism is greatly slowed, obesity may occur, and there are diminished thought processes. Your total metabolic rate is the rate of kilocalorie consumption needed for all activities, both voluntary and involuntary. With the basal metabolism rate, you were just sitting still. Your total metabolic rate measures daily life activity. Your basal metabolism rate actually accounts for most of your total metabolic rate. Your skeletal muscle contraction will cause the most dramatic short-term changes in your total metabolic rate. Food ingestion will also rapidly increase total metabolic rate. This is called food-induced thermogenesis. Proteins and alcohol will give you the greatest increase, but the fact that you're breaking down food increases your heat loss. Fasting or very low caloric intake will depress your total metabolic rate. Body temperature is the balance between heat production and heat loss. Now you have to maintain homeostatic ranges of body temperature even though your environment changes around you. Your body temperature should average about 37 degrees centigrade. The range is between 35.8 and 38.2 degrees centigrade. And since we're more used to Fahrenheit, the average is 98.6, with the range between 96 and 101. There are diurnal variations in the temperature. Your temperature is lowest in the morning and highest in the late afternoon or early evening. Maintaining a stable body temperature is necessary so that we maintain optimal enzyme activity. At a temperature of 106, convulsions may occur in children under 5. A body temperature of 109 degrees Fahrenheit is usually fatal. the body can withstand careful cooling better. And they've used cooling. They've taken the body down to 90 or 88 degrees Fahrenheit during certain surgeries to help reduce metabolic rates so that they can operate longer. Your core temperature is the temperature of your internal body structures. This is going to be your highest body temperature. The core temperature has to be precisely controlled by the hypothalamus. The blood is the agent of heat exchange between the core and the shell. Blood will be driven into organs if we need to conserve heat, or into the skin capillaries if we need to lose heat. The shell is the skin. This is going to be the lowest body temperature, and it's going to be more variable because you're exposed to external factors. There are basically four mechanisms of heat exchange. One is radiation. You simply radiate heat. You can feel it coming off of people if you go up close to them and don't quite touch them, but you'll feel heat coming off of them. One is conduction. If you touch anything, you transfer heat from yourself to that inanimate object. Convection is due to air currents. As you warm air around your body, warm air rises and that pulls cooler air up from the bottom for you to warm that air. So you always have these convection currents around you. And the fourth method is evaporation, which is heat loss due to water evaporation. There's always a certain basal level of heat loss through evaporation of water from the lungs and the oral mucosa and the skin. This is what we call insensible water loss, and there's an accompanying insensible heat loss that goes with it. When you are very active and you sweat, you have active evaporation. This is sensible heat and water loss. This is heat and water loss of which you're more aware. If we look at the balancing act, we have heat produced by your metabolism, muscular activity, hormones, and the fact that warmer cells metabolize faster and produce more heat. You lose heat through radiation, conduction and convection, and evaporation. If you have heavy or prolonged sweating, you lose water and sodium chloride. This can cause painful muscle spasms or cramps, sometimes called heat cramps. To treat this, you need to drink fluids and replace electrolytes. The hypothalamus helps regulate your temperature. There is a heat loss center and a heat promoting center in the hypothalamus. These regions receive information from thermoreceptors in the skin, the peripheral thermoreceptors, and from thermoreceptors in the core, called the central thermoreceptors. The central thermoreceptors have more influence on the hypothalamus than the peripheral thermoreceptors. Heat promoting mechanisms include things like constricting the cutaneous blood vessels. This would keep blood away from the surface so you wouldn't lose heat that way. Muscle contractions like shivering help generate heat. The adrenal medulla will release epinephrine and this will increase metabolic rate. We'll also have an enhanced release of thyroxine which will generate more metabolism. And then there are always behavioral modifications. You can put on warmer clothes, you can drink hot fluids, you can reduce exposed areas. If you're cold, you tend to hunch your back or clasp your arms together. You can also increase physical activity. You may start jumping up and down or waving your arms around, anything to make your muscles move a little more. If you're too warm, the heat loss mechanisms are things like dilating the cutaneous blood vessels. Bring the warm blood to the surface and let that heat radiate off and convection off. Also, sweating will be increased. This will give you evaporation powers. And you can take behavioral measures. You get still. You reduce your activity. You seek a cooler environment. You go stand in the shade. You fan yourself. You find air conditioning. You wear light-colored, loose-fitting clothing. This is actually cooler than being nude because bare skin will actually absorb radiant energy and make you warmer. Hyperthermia occurs if you're overexposed to a hot, humid environment. When this happens, evaporation does not work because of the humidity and it's too hot, so your normal heat loss mechanisms don't work properly. An elevated body temperature then depresses the hypothalamus. If your core temperature gets to be 105 degrees Fahrenheit, your heat control mechanisms are suspended. So hyperthermia can lead to heat stroke. In heat stroke, because we've suspended the normal heat controlling mechanisms, we start a positive feedback mechanism where whatever makes you hot, you just keep getting hotter and hotter. you increase the metabolism, and that keeps increasing the temperature. Because you're not doing what you're supposed to do, your body is not doing the right thing, you don't sweat. So someone goes from hyperthermia, they're pink and sweating. When they go into heat stroke, their skin gets hot and dry. If this continues, multiple organ damage can occur, including brain damage. You need to cool the body and administer fluids. Heat exhaustion, or exertion-induced heat exhaustion, is used to describe the extreme sweating and collapse of an individual following or during vigorous physical activity. They're going to have an elevated body temperature, they're usually a little confused mentally, and they may faint because of dehydration. They'll have pulled too much fluid out of the blood and they'll have a low blood volume. That will give them a low blood pressure. Heat exhaustion can spiral into heat stroke, and death occurs if the body is not cooled and rehydrated. Hypothermia is when you have a low body temperature. This is typically from prolonged exposure to cold. Vital signs decrease, metabolism slows, and drowsiness occurs. People start actually feeling comfortable as they slip into their cold-induced coma. They stop shivering when the core temperature gets between 87 and 90 degrees Fahrenheit. If untreated, this progresses to coma and death at about 70 degrees centigrade. Fever, or controlled hyperthermia, results from chemicals that are released in your body called pyrogens. Now, these can be released as a result of a bacterial infection, cancer, an allergic reaction, or injury to the central nervous system. Basically, pyrogens reset the hypothalamus. They reset the thermostat. And so your body now thinks instead of saying at 98.6, it should be 102. As a result, when you're developing fever, your heat-promoting mechanisms come into play. People who are developing a fever shiver. They get the chills. They get the shakes. Why? Because heat-promoting is increased muscle contraction. They become pale because their blood is being held in the core so that they don't lose heat. In other words, it's the regular thing they would do, and they're doing it to make their temperature higher because the hypothalamus thinks it's supposed to be higher. When the fever breaks, your heat loss mechanisms come into play. The pyrogens go away, the hypothalamus resets to 98.6, and now you sweat and you get very pink and you start losing that extra heat. Good nutrition is essential in utero. Nutrients will be pulled from the mother, but if there's a lack of calories for the fetus, you'll have poor development. Not enough protein in the diet will lead to poor brain development. Inadequate nutrition in the first trimester leads to mental deficits and learning disorders. Proteins are needed for muscle, calcium needed for bones. Once growth is complete, after you're out of the uterus and you've completed growing, you still need adequate nutrition to replace normal tissue. There are several inborn errors of metabolism. One is phenylketonuria. People who have this disease lack an enzyme to convert phenylalanine to tyrosine. Phenylalanine will accumulate in the blood, and this can damage the brain. PKU testing is done on newborns because if we can find this early, we can simply provide them a diet low in phenylalanine and we don't have the brain damage. Sometimes women who have phenylketonuria are encouraged to go back on the low phenylalanine diet while they're pregnant. Galactosemia is a condition where the sugar galactose is not converted to glucose in the liver. Galactosemia building up in the blood can cause mental deficits. In glycogen storage disease, glycogen cannot be converted back to glucose. As a result, glycogen is stored in the muscle and the liver and even other organs, and these organs enlarge. Metabolic syndrome is defined by the American Heart Association as a cluster of 5 risk factors: an increased waist circumference, above 32 inches for women, above 35 inches for men, increased blood pressure, increased blood glucose, increased blood triglycerides, and a decreased blood HDL cholesterol. These conditions all greatly increase the risk for heart disease, stroke, and type 2 diabetes. Normal adipose tissue function and visceral fat in the abdominal cavity give the apple appearance that is so common with metabolic syndrome. The best treatment is to decrease abdominal fat. This usually is by controlling caloric intake. There's no magic pill you can take to do this. As you age, your BMR declines, meaning you need fewer calories to carry out life processes. There is some muscle and bone wasting, and there's a decline of the endocrine system, so you may produce less thyroxine. Elderly people are less active, so they need fewer calories. Because they need fewer calories and their basal metabolism rate declines, just getting adequate nutrition may give them enough calories that they gain weight. The elderly also tend to use more medications. Since most medications are detoxified by the liver, this stresses the liver, and the liver, like everything else, is declining in its efficiency. Diuretics promote the loss of potassium. Antibiotics may interfere with digestion, and about 50% of the current older population consume alcohol. Some begin substituting alcohol for food. Browning reactions are an interesting phenomena that may be linked to some of the problems with aging. Browning reactions are when you have non-enzymatically controlled reactions between glucose and protein. You've seen this in hamburger at the grocery store, maybe. You've got that nice pink hamburger, and then if you take it home and let it sit in your refrigerator for a while, it gets that kind of brown color. That's because of Browning reactions. So you have that discoloration of food, and the food toughens up a little bit. Normally, all of the reactions in our body are controlled by enzymes, so they're very controlled reactions. And enzymatic reactions attach sugars to proteins only at specific sites, so we form glycoproteins. And these glycoproteins have well-defined roles in our body. But Browning reactions are not enzymatically controlled, and they're completely random. They start cross-linking proteins. This may be one of the causes of lens clouding or cataracts that occur in older people. And in general, they cause stiffening of tissues and loss of elasticity, something else that we have repeatedly said happens as you age, a loss of elasticity in all of your elastic tissues. So Browning reactions may be part of the cause of aging.